Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Waynesville. We are glad to have you with us this morning. I'm Reverend Christi Hollifield, one of the ministers here, and we welcome you this morning. We are here this morning to hear from God, to learn from God, and to talk to God. And our church's mission is to embody Christ, loving all people and introducing them to the God that we love. We conclude our sermon series this morning, the Trinity, three in one and one in three. And we're going to be focusing this morning on God as the three in one. If you are a guest with us this morning, please complete our guest information tab located in your bulletin. There is there are a couple of places that you can fill that out and put it. You can put it in the tithe box at the back of the sanctuary, and we have one beside each of these doors here. We would love to get to know more about you. There's also a really fun way of filling this out as well. You can take a picture of the QR code, and it will take you directly to the form and allow you to fill it out that way as well. So whichever of the two options, we would just love to hear more about you and be able to plug you into different things that are going on in our church. At the end of worship, if you will exit through these doors over across the hall to our Connections Coffee House, it's a wonderful time for fellowship before we start our small group sessions. We have a variety of snacks and coffee, that sort of thing, for us to begin our small groups with. If you're interested in a small group session, you can see one of us and we'll be happy to direct you. Or there's a listing of small groups on the bulletin board as you go into Connections Coffee House. It is a wonderful day to be in the house of the Lord. Let us all join together in prayer as we begin worship together. Father God, you sent your word to bring us truth and your spirit to make us holy. Through them we come to know the mystery of your life. Help us to worship you, one God, three persons, by proclaiming and living our faith in you. Grant this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Please take your hymnal and turn to hymn number 247, Come Thou Almighty King. Stand with me as we sing. Hymn number 247.
Thank you.
I'll be reading this morning from 1 John chapter 4, verses 13 through 16. We know that we live in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in him and he in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. Please pray with me. Dear Lord, we thank you. Thank you for loving us so much. We thank you for this beautiful morning, this wonderful day, for this opportunity of worship and fellowship and discipleship. Pray that your Spirit would move through us and work in us to open our eyes and our ears, our hearts and our minds, our very souls, to the reading of your word, so that we might find peace and understanding, and so that we might grow to know you more, Lord. We want to know you more. In your sweet, sweet name I pray. Amen. Children may come up for children's sermon. How are you this morning? Good. I'm glad to see you. So today we finish our study of God 3-in-1. We've been learning in Sunday school too about God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And remember our boards that we have in our Sunday school classroom? And we show that there are characteristics of both that are just alike, but then there's some certain things with God the Father and God the Son and God the Holy Spirit that are unique just to them, right? So God, our Father, is like a father to us, like a parent. He loves us and he takes care of us and he protects us and he's always there for us. And then he created us, God created us, all of us, the very world, out of love. Tons and tons and tons of love. So much we may never fully understand it. And then Jesus, God the Son, because he loved us so much, came to walk on the earth with us, to teach us, to help us learn about how to be a part of that family of God, not just the Jews, but the Gentiles, everybody, anyone and everyone who believed. And then when we believe, when we ask Christ to be our Savior, we have the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes and he's a part of us. Each individual people, but they make up one awesome God, right? And the Holy Spirit gives us wisdom. The Holy Spirit teaches us things. It helps us to be who it is that God wants us to be. And we're all in a huge family. We're all in communion. We fellowship, we love, we work together as one large body of Christians. Well, in our lesson today, that is what Paul is reminding the church in Ephesus. He's reminding them that, hey, when you come to know God and you allow Jesus in your heart, then the Spirit fills you. And he reminds them this most beautiful line. I'm going to read it to you. He says, and I pray that you, being rooted and stuck in and established in love, God's love, right? That may the power together with everybody in that huge family, all the saints, all the people before us, to grasp that we can understand how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. Isn't that beautiful? It's hard to imagine. It kind of blows our minds sometimes. But that is God. 3-in-1, 1-in-3. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this understanding over a period of time. We pray for continual knowledge, Lord, continual learning more about you as the Father, as the Son, and as the Holy Spirit, as we continue to grow in you. But Lord, we thank you for what we have gotten thus far. And we thank you most importantly for the enormous love that you have for us and all of us around us. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Oh,
Please remain standing and take your hymnal and turn to hymn number 248. God our Father, we adore thee. In the third stanza, there is an old word referring to the Holy Spirit called paraclete. It's a translation from John 14. It means advocate or friend or counselor. And so when you get to that word, and also if you notice, we're using the Aramaic word for daddy in the first stanza in Abba, praises we proclaim. Sing with me, hymn number 248, God our Father.
Great to see all of you here this morning, and again, welcome to our worship service. Let's pray together as we worship the Lord through the Word. Father, we are grateful for this day, grateful for your presence, grateful for your love, and we now pray, God, you would be with us as we worship you through your Word. We pray, God, that we would set aside all the busyness, all the distractions of the week, Lord, and help us to focus on you and what you want to say to us today. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Please take your Bible and turn with me to the book of Ephesians, chapter 3. And our text comes from verses 14 to 21. Ephesians 3, 14 to 21. There it's written, "For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ. And to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Our worship unit is about the Trinity, three in one and one in three. That's been the focus of our worship unit, this very important, critical doctrine in our lives. And in prior weeks, we've looked at God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Today we come to look at the three in one, God as Trinity. Now, as we started our message each week, we started off by looking at a piece of iconic art. By iconic art, we mean art that contains a lot of symbolism with it, by an artist named Andrei Rublev from the 15th century. And we've looked through the rich imagery. The name of this piece of art is the Trinity. Actually, it's Trinity in Russian. I can't pronounce the Russian name. But it's the Trinity. And what Rublev did is he used the image or the picture of the story of the three visitors to Abraham recorded in Genesis chapter 18. And so he depicts these three visitors. And in prior weeks, we've seen several things about it. And this is the enhanced version, helps you to see it a little bit better. We've seen that we believe the identity of the figures is from left to right, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And that they are gathered together there, and before them on the table is a cup symbolizing communion and salvation. We've seen that they are, that both the Son and the Holy Spirit are bowing their heads towards the Father, but that they're all on the same level. They have they have identical faces and identical bodies relating to each other, implying equality between the three. We see that their bodies, their faces, and their wings, again, are all identical. We see above the Son, kind of back to the right of him, is a tree, symbolizing the oak of Mamre in the Genesis story, but also symbolizing the cross on which Jesus died and the tree of life in heaven at the end of the age. So that's also operating there. We see that the Holy Spirit is, both the Son and the Holy Spirit are wearing blue. You can't really see it, but it magnifies a little bit of blue that's in the Father, showing that both Holy Spirit and Son magnify the Father. Last week we saw that the Holy Spirit is wearing green, which in Russia is the color of Pentecost. So, represents the coming of the Holy Spirit. Now, I want to throw out a couple of things here that are a little bit more obscure, but are interesting to look at that kind of relate to today's message. First of all, if you look at you'll see it in a moment, but when you look at the posture of the three bodies and the heads, you'll see that they form something of a cup like that. And so that cup there symbolizes the Lord's Supper and communion, the giving of salvation. Another important aspect of it is you notice there's an empty space in there. There's a space right in the middle there. And that space says, you're invited. Come in. Join in this communion with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And so today, we're going to talk about that last act, we're going to focus on that last aspect, the invitational part, the invitation to come in and experience the glorious communion of the Trinity. And we're going to find that we worship God the Trinity, three persons in one being. Now, in my very first message, I mentioned that even though the word Trinity doesn't appear anywhere in the Bible, that it's derived from the Bible. Now, the natural question is where? You know, where in the Bible do you find reflected the idea of the Trinity? Some folks find it reflected in the Old Testament, and it may be, but it's very faint there, if at all. It's not really strong there at all. We really have to come to the New Testament in order to find the scriptural expressions of the idea of the Trinity. And just a few of the passages in there include Matthew 28:19. You remember that? That's the Great Commission passage, a passage that's dear to us Baptists. And Christ concludes that by saying, baptizing them, what, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. There they are together, mentioned as, and three names there from Jesus. So you have the three there named and in close proximity to each other. And Jesus commands, saying, as you go out and baptize people, baptize them in the name of these three together as you do that. Another example is over in the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 14, this famous benediction that Paul has at the end of that. As Paul says, may the love of God, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. There it is, Father, Son, Holy Spirit together. Now, that being said, there's not a developed theology of the Holy Spirit in the New Testament. That comes more in the early church era, in the centuries right after the New Testament was written. It seems the first person to use the word Trinity was a guy named Theophilus of Antioch, who lived in the late 100s, late 2nd century AD. Now, during the early church era, various church councils were meetings of church leaders from across the world. Various church councils came together and devoted themselves to the doctrine. And this included the 4th century councils at Nicaea and Chalcedon. Both of those came about to define the nature of the Trinity. And it took the church a while to work through that, to come up with kind of a coherent view of that. But where the church centered on was this idea of God as one being in three persons, and that these three persons were equal within God. Now, naturally, not everybody agreed with that. A number of people disagreed with that. And the three main camps of disagreement were the Unitarians, the Modalists, and the Tritheists. You might ask, who are they and what did they believe? Well, very briefly, Unitarians, which exist, and all these groups are around in some form to this day, Unitarians believe there was just one God, and that there was, and that Son and Holy Spirit are not in any way in God or equal to God. Unitarians will say that Jesus was maybe a good man whom God adopted, or was a person whom God created, but that the Son and the Holy Spirit are not equal to God. Then there were the modalists. Modalists kind of used the picture, the illustration that, for example, I am a father, I'm a son, and I'm also a husband. I'm the same person, but I have three different roles or modes in my life, which sounds good, but still is not it. That's not the Trinity. So there are modalists around today as well. The third view is tritheism, which says there are three gods, three separate gods. In fact, many outside groups like Muslims accuse us of being tritheists, that we believe in three gods. But we don't believe in three gods. We believe in one God with three persons, which is a very nuanced and, it we'll see, not too easily grasped idea. So, when we come to try to understand the Trinity, one of the first questions we ask is, how do we understand it? First of all, can it be understood? Can the Trinity be understood at all? And in many ways, we can say that the Trinity is a mystery. Now, one great Christian spiritual teacher said, In the sense of the Trinity, a mystery is not something that can never be understood. The Trinity is something that is constantly understood. In other words, we're always trying to understand it. And we never can quite get it nailed down. If you're like me, you want things nailed down. You know, you want it ABC, 1, 2, 3, subpoints, bullet points, all of that, all organized and all perfectly in a row. But the Trinity is not like that. The Trinity escapes any kind of frame we try to put it in. So it's constantly being understood. So where do we start to understand it? Do we start with the one or do we start with the three? Where do we start to discern that? Now, since we, and we'll talk about this in a moment, since we are individualistic to the core, we are strongly individualistic people, you know, we're the lone warrior, the good guy out there fighting by ourselves. So we are individualists, but since we're individualists, we tend to start with the one, not the three. But to really understand the Trinity, we start by focusing on the three because the three defines the nature of the one. In other words, you got to start with the three because the three helps you understand what the one looks like. So that's very important to remember. Now, another sad fact about us, not only are we individualists, we're also hierarchicalists, which basically means we look at relationships as a pyramid. There's a person at the top. That person rules over this group of people and this group of people. And we have a pecking order, in other words. So we have this hierarchy of somebody at the top who's in control. And so we Americans especially tend towards hierarchy, and we also tend towards individualism. So when you put those together, we as a people have that, and that's one reason or one explanation why racism persists in our country. Because we look at things individualistically and in a pyramid. There has to be a superior race. One group of people has to be better than another. And so we constantly struggle with that. So we'll talk about that in a moment. The thing is, when I'm centered on my race, I'm centered on me and my place in the world. When I'm centered on my race, I'm centered on me and my place in the world. So the Trinity takes us away from those kinds of things. It draws us towards God. And as we look at this and we try to consider it, we find that the Trinity takes us from that. And the reason why that does is that the Trinity is not an individualistic entity, nor is it a pyramid. And so the more we focus on the Trinity, the more we're drawn away from these toxic things that can infect us in life. Now, as the early church fathers looked at the nature of the Trinity and tried to understand it, to me, one of the very interesting images they came up with was they described the Trinity as a circle dance. A circle dance of agape love. And this is kind of what a circle dance looks like. Three in a circle holding hands, dancing together. Now, they must not have been Baptist to come up with that kind of image. But they're in this circle dance together. And I think dance is a great image because dance implies interaction, harmony, cooperation, movement, and feeling, especially love, joy. There's no individualism in the Trinity because God is three, not just one. There's no hierarchy because all are equal within the Trinity. Furthermore, they share love. 1 John 4:8 says, God is love. So if, and the word that he uses there is the special New Testament word for love, agape, which is a word that God led the New Testament writers to use to draw from which was God's unique self-giving love. So God is agape love. And if God is agape, then it follows that Father, Son, and Holy Spirit share eternal agape love in this circle dance. That's the nature of the Trinity itself, that they share this love with each other. That's wonderful. That's great. That gives us inspiration and joy, and it's great to contemplate that. But what does that mean to us? Is there another step to this? And the answer is yes. The great message of the scripture is that God has called us, invited us into this circle dance of love. God's invited us to come into this and enter it. Over in 1 John chapter 4, verses 13 to 18, we read this. This is how we know that we live in Him and He in us. He has given us of His Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent the Son. There's Father, Son, Holy Spirit there. See that close? To be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. And so we know and rely on the love God has for us. God is love. Whoever lives in love, and that's that word agape, lives in God and God in them. What a fantastic passage that God invites us into this. And so the circle becomes bigger, a bigger circle now, as there are more people within it. You know, it's got a circle of five now. And so God invites us into this circle to enjoy the communion of agape love within Him. This shows us once again that only knowing facts about God is insufficient. What we're called to is not just knowing facts about God. We're called to know God. The words in the Bible for know mean not just intellectual knowledge. They mean experiential knowledge. So we're called to enter into the Trinity and to experience God, to experience this eternal communion as love. God calls us to know Him as the Trinity. And as we enter the circle dance of the Trinity, in other words, God says, I want you to know me as Trinity. And God says, I invite you to join in that communion of the Trinity. But as we enter into that circle dance in that great image, God reminds us that, hey, we're not the only ones He's invited. He's invited others into that dance. He's invited others into that eternal communion. We find this over in 1 John chapter 1, early in this book of John, chapter 1, verses 2 to 3. Listen to what John says. He says, the life appeared, he's talking about Jesus, the life appeared, we have seen it and testified to it, and we proclaim to you the eternal life, which was with the Father and has appeared to us. We proclaim to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us, meaning himself, John, and the church, and our fellowship is with the Father and His Son, Jesus Christ. Notice that stream there. The word He uses for fellowship is the word koinonia. It means a holding in common. So He says, our fellowship in the church together, we enjoy that, and we have a fellowship with the Father. And now we invite you to come into that and enjoy that fellowship with us. Come in with us. You're invited. Be a part of that through the Lord Jesus Christ, through faith in Him. This suggests that the community of Christ followers, which we are, the community of Christ followers should be characterized by the agape love of the Trinity. If we're in that fellowship, if we are communing with the eternal God of love, then that love should be reflected in our relationships with each other within the congregation. That we share that love together as God's people. The church should model the reality of the Trinity. In other words, people should be able to say, hey, the Trinity is real. Look at the church. Look at how they relate to each other. Look how they love. That should be a sign to the world. At the same time, the koinonia we share with the Trinity is open, not closed. Takes us back to the Rublev picture, the open spot at the table. There should always be open spots at our table. Always reaching out, always sharing. What's true of the Trinity should be true of us. We should imitate the life of the Trinity by loving everybody and inviting them into our koinonia. That's how we imitate the works of the Trinity. Sadly, we fall short of that ideal many times. We are not what we ought to be. Part of our problem is, as I said before, we swim in a culture of individualism and hierarchicalism. We swim in that culture and we are so formed by it. It infects us. And we have a hard time overcoming it. When Peyton Gendron went into the top supermarket in Buffalo, he didn't see black people as people God commanded him to love. He didn't see black people as people to be included, really, into this eternal fellowship of love. Instead, he saw them as threats to his race, threats to his place, threats to where he wanted to be. He saw them as people who were trying to replace him and his race. Now, we might say, and it's true, certainly this was a mentally disturbed person. But this mentally disturbed person was brewed in a stew of white supremacy and replacement theory. That was all part of that. So he was stewed in that and endued in these ideas that are narcissism and heresy, that don't reflect God's love. Anyone who finds white supremacy, racism, and replacement theory consistent with Christianity neither knows the scriptures nor the Trinity. They don't understand the nature of that. On the positive side, the only hope I see in our current environment today is for us Christ followers to take the idea of the Trinity seriously, to take it to heart, and take seriously the love demonstrated in it. That we reach out in love the way the Trinity calls us to do. We have to commit ourselves to practicing agape love with each other and with outsiders. That doesn't mean we're all always going to agree on things. We have a lot of disagreements about a lot of things. But we can agree to love each other through those disagreements. We can agree to model that love in how we relate to each other and care for each other in these deep ways. We also need to commit ourselves to practicing agape love even with outsiders, whoever they are, wherever they come from, whatever their ideas are. The scriptures don't say God so loved the good people of the world or the righteous people of the world, or the morally correct people of the world. He loved the world that he gave his one and only son. We need to cast aside racism and white supremacy as dirty rags and put on the clothing of Christ, who loved everybody and gave his life for everybody. So what can we take away from today? What are the very important points? One, to best understand the Trinity, we start with the threeness, not the oneness. The Trinity is not a pyramid. It's not an individual, but it's a circle dance. Beyond that, communion with the Trinity, again, is this circle. This circle of love together with Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Next, God invites all into this communion, not just a few people, The invitation to come originates in the Father, is activated by the Son, and sealed by the Spirit, bringing us into that. Finally, God calls us to reflect the communion of the Trinity in our love. We're to reflect that in the way we love each other and the way we love outsiders. May our communion be like that. May we devote ourselves to the mission of bringing outsiders into the communion of the Trinity through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And may we use the instruments of love and grace in order to bring them in. Let's pray. Today we invite you to follow the Lord Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior if you've never done that before. We're going to sing a hymn of commitment and invite you to become a Christ follower. The way you do that is you pray in your heart to receive Christ. You can do that right where you are. Invite Jesus into your heart. In a moment again, we're going to sing, and if you want to receive Christ, I'll be standing here at the front and we'll be glad to share with you how you can do that. You may have another decision or commitment to make. Maybe you want to recommit your life to the Lord. Maybe you want to join this church. Maybe you just want to come to the front and kneel and pray. But won't you respond to God's love for you and God's love for the people around you? Dear Father, we thank you that you love us as we are and that you invite us to yourself as we are. Father, we pray that we would truly be your people in this troubled world, in this time and place. Help us to stand for the values that are most important. But Lord, help us to be above all a people of self-giving, self-sacrificial love, who love each other deeply and who hold hands out to our community, inviting others to experience that love. And we thank you, God, for the fellowship that we enjoy with you. We pray that would grow and that others would come into your fellowship. And again, if there's one here this morning who is not in that fellowship, that he or she will be starting today. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
All right, let's stand together and sing as we continue to worship. I believe in Christ.
Next song we're going to sing is by Third Day. It's called, Yeah, You Are So Good to Me. I keep thinking, You Are So Beautiful, which is in the song. But anyway, it speaks to the Trinity. It's about the Trinity. And it speaks to how the Trinity relates with us and how God the Father is always with us. And Jesus the Son died for us and rose again to save us. And that the Holy Spirit is with us to guide and direct us in everything we do. And just sing with me as we continue to worship.
You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. You are beautiful, my sweet, sweet song. I will sing again. You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father in heaven. You are so good to me. You heal my broken heart. You are my Father. You died upon the cross. You are my Jesus who loves me. You poured out all your blood. You died upon the cross. You are
God's people said, amen.
It is great to have you here today. A couple of announcements to remind you of. First of all, Gracie Woods is going to come share with us a mission moment, so please be seated. And we're going to hear a good word about Gracie, about a good ministry she's involved with.
Hello. So for those of you who don't know me, my name is Gracie, and I'm leading a women's ministry at NC State. And I just wanted to show you guys some photos from this year and thank you for your prayers and your support and just share the good news. So a year ago, like during COVID, we had 7 girls coming and 5 of those girls were leaders. And so we just prayed this year for some change to happen. And you'll see in these photos, when we get back to the big group, we had so many women show up this semester. So we averaged like 20 to 30, and it was just amazing. So we studied through the book of Genesis, and we taught girls who had never read scripture before how to encounter God in the scripture and encounter his heart, and just teach them what it looks like to have that relationship with him. And just the best thing, these pictures right there, and the next one's coming up, I had the amazing experience of baptizing one of my best friends who accepted Christ last semester. So God is changing lives, saving people in this ministry, and I just want to thank you guys for that and for the prayers there. So we will be doing a Bible study this summer, so continue to pray that we have girls show up over Zoom and pray for my leader team as I have 8 girls that I'll be leading with this next year. So I just appreciate all of the support and love that you guys send us. So thank you.
We so much appreciate the ministry Gracie does there and ask for your continued prayers and support. Just one announcement, youth parents, please remember you have a youth parent meeting at 12:30 today in the MAC. A light lunch will be served. So we want to remind all of our youth parents about that. Also want to remind all of you and especially our guests, you're invited to join us for Coffee Connections. Just go straight through these exit doors into our gym. We have coffee and other kinds of hot and cold drinks and goodies for you. And we'd like a chance to meet you, get to know you better. We also have small groups available. We'll be glad to direct you to one, help you find one if you're interested in that. Also want to remind everybody we have offering boxes to give an offering today. We have one box in the back and 2 boxes here, one by each door. If you'd like to give an offering today, we'd really appreciate it, and just drop it into those boxes. Now let's stand together, and we're going to have a closing Gloria Patri. Thank you. You're dismissed.